Welcome back, children. So coming to today's class, we'll be studying about x-rays. Okay, so x-rays, how are they produced and their classification, which is quite important for objective pattern exams. So coming to x-rays, we have already studied it is a part of electromagnetic spectrum. Okay, whose wavelength ranges from 0.1 angstrom to 100 angstroms. Okay, so since they have a very small wavelength, they are have a high frequency. Frequency is very high. And if frequency is very high, obviously they have high energy. Okay, these are high energy radiations. So X-rays were first discovered by a scientist, Rontgen. And he named them as X-rays because he found some unknown rays which were affecting the photographic plate and undeflected by electric and magnetic fields, and he called those unknown radiations as X-rays. So later on, we have produced X-rays by making use of a tube or a discharge tube that's called a Coolidge tube. So let us see how a Coolidge tube is constructed and how are we going to get this beam of X-rays. Look at the Coolidge tube, okay, the discharge tube where we produce X-rays. This is called a Coolidge tube. Okay, so this consists of a discharge tube, an evacuated discharge tube. Okay, one end of it is connected to an electron gun. Just like the Davison and Germer experiment, this is an electron gun which is connected to a battery of low potential. Okay, we call it as the filament voltage. Okay, when you connect it to a battery through a key, this filament gets heated and then it liberates electrons. Okay, so this is a electron gun which is going to generate electrons, and by increasing the filament voltage, you can increase the number of electrons which are coming out of this electron gun. Now these electrons are accelerated towards the target. Okay, so we take a target as a heavy metal, okay, for example tungsten or molybdenum. Okay, remember the characteristics of the target. They should have a high specific heat. Okay, because if specific heat is very high, it takes a long time for increasing the temperature of the target. Apart from this, it should have a high melting point. Because when you accelerate these electrons and they go and hit this target, a large amount of heat is produced. So to transfer the heat quickly or to let this metal heat slowly, okay, we are making use of a material which is having a very high specific heat. And if at all, if there is any heat produced in this metal, it is transferred to a copper rod. Okay, it is followed by a copper rod. We know copper rod has low specific heat, which will quickly absorb the heat from the target, and we pour cold water or running water cold water is run around this target in order to cool it, and this is connected to another battery which is called as a high potential battery or an accelerated potential. Okay, so this is called an accelerated voltage. Okay, so this is going to accelerate the electrons. I again repeat the experimental arrangement. It consists of an electron gun connected to a low tension or a filament battery or filament voltage, which generates a beam of electrons. So these electrons are accelerated by using this accelerated potential. If you want to increase the kinetic energy of electrons, increase the applied voltage to the anode. So these electrons are accelerated towards the target. So we get a beam of electrons. So when this beam of electrons come and hit the target, a heavy metal target, most of their energy is lost in the form of heat, and this decelerated electron, okay, we know whenever charge is accelerating or decelerating, it generates electromagnetic radiation. The decelerated electron will generate electromagnetic waves, and we are calling this electromagnetic waves as X-rays. So how are X-rays produced? Okay, one way of producing X-rays is make a beam of electrons or cathode rays. If they come and hit a heavy metal target, most of the energy is lost in the form of heat. Apart from that, some electromagnetic radiations are released. This is because of the decelerating charge, that is decelerating electron, and that is having a wavelength ranging from 0.1 to 100 angstroms, which are called as X-rays. There is one more way in which X-rays can be produced. If these electrons can penetrate the atom of tungsten, okay, they go into the tungsten, okay, we know even this atom has electrons in its innermost shells. Okay, if you consider this as the nucleus, it is surrounded by a number of orbits, assuming Bohr's atomic model to be true. Okay, so here we have the electron. So this external electron will come and knock out the electron from the K shell. If it releases an electron from the K shell, electron comes out, creating a vacancy here. And once a vacancy is created, electrons present in L, M and N shells will come and occupy this place. So a transition occurs from L to K or M to K or N to K. This also will release energy, which is nothing but called as X-ray. So these X-rays, we call them as characteristic X-rays. Due to deceleration of electrons, also we get X-rays. We call them as continuous X-rays. So continuous X-rays are produced due to deceleration of the beam of electrons. And characteristic X-rays produce when this electron goes and knocks out an electron from the inner shells, and outer electrons are going and occupying this place, releasing electromagnetic radiation. So this is how X-rays can be produced, either by decelerating, both simultaneously taking place. One is characteristic, the other one is continuous. Now once again I repeat, remember these two points. If you increase the filament voltage, the filament current will increase. If filament current increases, well, we get more number of electrons. So if you want to increase the intensity of X-rays, by increasing the intensity of electrons, you have to increase the filament voltage. So again, I'm repeating, if filament voltage increases, number of electrons will increase, number of photons also will increase, intensity of X-rays will increase. If you want more energetic X-rays, then I have to increase this accelerating voltage. So when you increase this V, voltage connected to the target, then we get more energetic electrons, hence more energetic X-rays. So these two points you have to remember for objective pattern questions. Now if you look into the continuous and characteristic X-rays, okay, just now I told you that these electrons are accelerated by this potential V. So how can we write the kinetic energy of electrons as the kinetic energy of electrons is equal to E into V, where V is the accelerating voltage. Now this is converted into, most of the energy, I said, it is lost in the form of heat plus electromagnetic radiation, and this electromagnetic radiation itself we are calling it as X-rays. Now if you take the ideal case, okay, what is the ideal case? If the heat produced or heat energy dissipated is zero, then the whole kinetic energy of the electrons is converted into electromagnetic radiation. But it does not happen, just an assumption. Then what will be the wavelength and frequency? If heat production is zero, your total kinetic energy of electrons is converted into h nu. Then can I write EV is equal to h nu max? If heat produced is, if heat energy lost is zero, or E into V is equal to H into, this is called the maximum frequency of X-rays. If I write frequency as C by lambda, lambda becomes minimum. So what is the minimum wavelength of X-rays possible in a Coolidge tube? It is HC divided by E into V, okay, where V is the accelerating voltage. Now, if you put the values of HC and E, I can write lambda minimum as 1240 by capital V in nanometer. The value of HC by E is 1240. Okay? You can check this value because for numericals it will be helpful to get the answer quickly. So this gives you the minimum wavelength of x-rays. Now let us plot a graph between intensity of x-rays and wavelength of x-rays and see what inference we are going to get. Okay, now if you observe intensity versus wavelength graph. Okay, on y-axis I am taking the intensity of x-rays and x-axis wavelength. Okay, just now I told you there is a minimum wavelength which is possible for x-rays provided there is no heat dissipated. So when you plot a graph between intensity and wavelength, it starts from certain minimum value. Okay, this is the minimum wavelength, but this minimum wavelength will have zero intensity. Okay, I told you it's an ideal case. Heat production can never become a zero. So as wavelength is increasing, we observe this also will increase, and then again for higher wavelengths intensity decreases. So this was an experimentally observed observation. See, in the middle range of wavelengths you have high intensities, where intensity is less for lower wavelengths also, intensity is decreasing for even higher wavelengths. So this graph represents continuous x-rays which are produced by decelerating electrons. Now within this I will also show the characteristic x-rays. So to understand this characteristic x-rays, so let's go back to the energy levels of the target nuclei. Okay, so here I'll write the energy levels KLMN. Okay, so assume that this is the K shell, N equal to 1, then L MN, N shells of the target atom. I told you that characteristic x-rays are produced when the incoming electrons will knock out the electron from K shell. So if electron from K shell is removed, immediately who will react? The electrons present in L orbit will transit and occupy this place, releasing energy in the form of electromagnetic radiation. So we call this line as K alpha line. Okay, like in case of hydrogen spectrum, we have called it as H alpha, H beta for Balmer series. So a transition from L to K will release a photon, and the frequency of photon is the frequency for which line? K alpha line. Similarly, if M to K transition occurs, I'll call it as K beta, K gamma and so on. So this is called K series of X-rays. If electron jumps from M to L or N to L, any higher to L, we call this as L series. This is L alpha and this is L beta line. So I have written K alpha and K beta. Now observe the energy gap. This energy gap is less, whereas this energy gap is more. More energy, lesser will be the wavelength. So the wavelength corresponding to K beta will be less than the wavelength corresponding to K alpha. Similarly, the same rule here. Wavelength of L beta will be less when compared with wavelength of L alpha line. But what about the intensity? See, whenever a vacancy is created in K shell, immediately reacting element or immediately reacting electron will be from the L shell. So reaction occurs quickly from L. Later M will react and occupy this position. So intensity of K alpha line will be greater than intensity of K beta. The same thing happens here because neighbors will react first. So intensity of K L alpha will be greater than intensity of L beta. Now if I show all these wavelengths in the same graph of continuous x-rays, so look at how do we represent them. So in between the graph you observe the peaks. So first I am showing K series. So I have shown you that lambda of K beta is less when compared with lambda of K alpha. So you observe the peaks here. Okay, this is for lambda for K alpha. Okay, this is the wavelength for K beta. Okay, wavelength of K beta is less when compared with wavelength of k alpha. And observe the peak intensity is more for k alpha line. Intensity is little less for which line? K beta line. So these are for K series. If you represent L series, L will be beside this. Okay, so this is for L alpha line and L beta and their corresponding wavelengths. This is for L beta, L alpha. So what does the peaks in the graph indicate? The characteristic X-rays. Okay, it is called characteristic because wavelength changes based on the target element. Okay, depending on which target you are selecting, the wavelength of K alpha, K beta keeps on changing. So you can explain this by using Rydberg's equation. If I take for K series, so from Rydberg's equation, if I write to write the wavelength for K alpha line, okay, we know 1 by lambda is equal to Z square into capital R. But when you are writing Z square, remember it is Z effective. Effective atomic number. What is effective atomic number? It is the atomic number of the nuclei minus screening constant. Okay, where B is called the screening constant. So Z effective square into capital R into 1 by lower energy level minus 1 by higher energy level. So transition is taking place from n equal to 2 to n equal to 1. See, this is n equal to 2, 3 and 4. For K alpha line, transition is from 2 to 1. So put the values 1 by 1 square minus 1 by 2 square. This is 1 minus 1 by 4, which is 3 by 4. So this equation gives me the wavelength of K alpha line. But if you want to find its frequency, okay, here I will write 1 by lambda, meaning lambda for K alpha line is Z effective square into capital R into 3 by 4 multiply with C. C by lambda for K alpha line is Z effective square into 3 RC by 4, which gives me the frequency for which line? K alpha line. So frequency of K alpha line is Z effective square into 3 RC by 4. Apply square root on either sides. Square root of frequency is Z effective into under root 3 RC by 4. I have written it for K alpha alone. So if I generalize this relation, okay, root 3 RC by MCR, I mean 3 RC by 4 is a constant. Z effective, if I write it as Z minus B, what are we getting this relation as? What will this relation become? Square root of frequency is Z minus B, and all these constants, if I write it as A, remember this relation? Do we call it as Moseley's law? Square root of frequency is equal to Z minus B into A. So for K alpha line, it is 3R by C. And for all K series, screening constant is 1. Okay, the value of screening constant is equal to 1, but only for K series. So this is how you can even obtain Moseley's law by using this Rydberg's relation. So this is regarding the X-rays. So one classification of X-rays, I told you it is continuous and characteristic. There is one more classification of X-rays, soft and hard X-rays. That depends on the penetration power. If the penetration power of X-rays is less, we call them as soft X-rays. If penetration power is more, we call them as hard X-rays. So that is also one of the classifications. But here important is, you have to remember the position of the peaks. Which is having more intensity and which is having less wavelength and so on. So based on graph and based on lambda minimum, you get some numericals. So based on increasing the filament current, what happens to intensity of X-rays? If you increase accelerated voltage, what happens to kinetic energy of electrons and kinetic energy of X-rays? I mean, X-rays energy. So this type of questions are very often given. So remember this, the nature of the target and so on. So So that's all in this topic of X-rays.